place in God, where nothing called self can be exalted. It's a place where we all have to lose ourselves to find it in Him. It's a place where one has to be dead to live again. And I ain't talking about physical death, but the Bible says, except a wheat of corn dies, it cannot grow. It's a place where one has to deny oneself and become alive in God. Romans 8 and verse 5 says, for they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. I want to be at that place where the things of this world will become strangely dim and be led only by the Spirit of God, where God can truly operate through me. Lord, take me to that place in you.
There is a place.
Yes, Lord.
Where I truly long to be.
Thank you, Jesus.
A place of happiness.
Yes, Lord. Oh, yeah.
And sweet serenity. Mm-hmm. Peace of rest.
Rest in me.
Where my soul belongs to thee.
Yes, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Envy, jealousy, bitterness, malice, and strife have no dominion, oh God. It's a place where the Spirit of God will be so alive that when you see me, it's not me, but the Christ that's living in me, manifesting through me, that one can only say, truly God lives in this place. Don't hide yourself from me. I wanna see your glory. Take control of me. Please let me lose myself in thee. A higher place is where I wanna be. You're here. Take me behind the veil. I wanna see your face, oh Lord. And in your presence, Lord, where I wanna be. Joy behind the veil. My mind is so at ease, Lord, when I'm standing in your glory and your grace.
Take me behind the veil. I wanna see your face.
And in your presence, Lord, is where I
hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory, glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. Blessed be the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Well, hallelujah. Welcome to Choice Gospel Network. Blessed be the name of the Lord. My name is Diane Moy, and I'm going to be ministering the Word of God to you tonight. Hallelujah. We give Him praise and we thank Him so much. I am privileged and honored to be at this station at this time. I am so blessed and I thank God so much for what He's doing in your life and what He's doing in my life. As we gather around the radio tonight to hear what the Lord is saying to us tonight, I'm believing by faith that you're going to receive and come up higher in Jesus' name. Amen. Most blessed Heavenly Father, we come to you this night in the matchless name of Jesus. We thank you, Almighty God, that you sit high and you look low. Bless the airwaves, my God. Bless the hearers, my God. Father, whatever medium they're listening to, in the dial-up, on the computers, my God, on the radio itself, we just bless your name and we thank you, Almighty God. Father, we're believing souls to come into the kingdom this night, north, south, east, and west. Come in, come in, come in. Hallelujah. So, Father, we thank you that you have your own way tonight. We thank you, Almighty God, that we're going to come up a little higher with each other and we're going to hear just what it is you have us to hear and to do in Jesus' name. I want to thank all the brothers that do help me, and the sisters too. Amen. And I want to say hello to my newest brother, Andrew. Andrew, hello. If you're on, I just want to say thank you so much that you are a blessing in my life, and I thank God for you. And welcome to the family of God. Amen. Amen. So tonight, the Lord wants to remind you of how special and wonderful you are. Just before I get started, I want to make a little correction, a little apology. Last week I was talking about Jehovah Gomorrah, you know, the God of recompense and the God of compensation. And I was going to go on to talk about when the Word of God says that we shouldn't provoke our children. The children, I'm very sensitive when it comes to children. And I made a statement. I want to let you know that I am not here to be an offense to anybody. However, if the word does convict you, then I have achieved what it is that the Lord has put me here to do. When I say that the person behaved disgustingly or whatever, I want to retract just to fix that. When you're not behaving in a godly manner, your behavior is ungodly. Your behavior is unseemly. Your behaving is disgusting. Your behavior, not you. You can never be disgusting. Even the unsaved person is not disgusting because God has died for them and they always have a chance of reconciliation. So if I seemed a little curt or a little angry last week, I was, and I am, and I have the privilege and honor to be angry. He says, be angry and sin not, because I do not and I will not tolerate abuse of children. Okay, so when you act in an ungodly manner, your behavior is ungodly. But you as the person, you always have a chance for repentance and redeemed. Okay, amen and amen. The Lord chastiseth who he loveth. I love you. Sometimes we have to say, ouch, ouch, hallelujah. All right, I guess you know Sister Diane by now, okay? Amen and amen. Okay, tonight we're going to, we can touch on this topic. We're going to be in the book of Ephesians, amen. Ephesians 2, 10 to 13. That's going to be right now our foundation scripture. Ephesians 2, 10 through 13. Amen. It is about, we're going to be learning tonight about reconciliation through Christ and taking our position in Christ. Amen. It's a very big topic and we're going to touch on it tonight. And then, you know, I expect and the Lord expects you to do your homework on your own. Amen. Okay. So it says in 10, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore, remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcised by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. 13. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Amen. And what are we talking about in these four scriptures? We're talking about reconciliation through Christ. And it says here, you know, that we were just a mess going nowhere. We couldn't get into what God had called for us. We couldn't partake in the promises of God. We were uncircumcised. And you know, in that day, that the Jews had to be circumcised to prove their devotion and their love for the Lord and that they were holy. So we had zippity-doo-dah-zero, okay? But when Christ came, he leveled the playing field, and we've been reconciled through Christ. It says in 13, but now in Christ Jesus, you who are sometimes far off are made nigh, which means close, by the blood of Christ, and we have been reconciled. Amen? I want to remind you tonight of who you are in Christ. I want to remind you again about getting your words to line up with who you are in Christ. You know, one of the reasons why the Lord refers to us as peculiar people is because we're supposed to be so odd and strange. We're supposed to be saying what the Bible says. If it doesn't say it in the Bible, we are not supposed to speak it. And time and time again, we all do this. I've done it myself. I'm a little bit more conscious of it now because I'm teaching. And so, you know, it makes me more conscious of it. That we're fine. And then we say things like, I'm a sinner. Even when I hear people calling on the counseling prayer line, they'll say, that enemy, he's so busy and I'm just a sinner and I'm unworthy. You have to get that out of your mouth. Who do you think will respond to you when you're speaking like that? Do you think that prompts God? God cannot respond to that because you're not speaking his word. I want you to get that into your thinking and then into your spirit, man. God cannot respond to things that are not his. You are his, but when you speak unbelief, he's out of there. He cannot respond to it because he doesn't have it in him. That junk belongs to the enemy. Amen. So let me tell you some of the things you inherited. And I mean, I'm really just brushing the surface. Please look up your stuff and see the inheritance that you have the day you said, yes, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Amen. Now that you are in Christ, and I told you that foundation scripture again is Ephesians 2, 10 through 13. It is when we begin to take our place, you begin to assume your rights and privileges in Christ, that God will begin to respond to you. Amen? Now that you're in Christ Jesus, you have entered into Christ. You can find that in Ephesians 1, 10 through 13. And also in Colossians 1 through 12. Jesus, when you believed in the gospel of salvation, you got saved from everything. There's nothing missing, nothing broken in the born-again believer's life. You've made the great exchange. You are seated in heavenly places with him. You are holy now, and you are without blame. You are in him before God. Hallelujah. And you will walk and talk and have your moving and your being in him. In him, Jesus Christ, you have redemption. What do you have redemption from? What are you saved from? What are you redeemed from? Redeemed means to be bought. How were you bought? You were bought with his body. You were bought with his death and resurrection. He bought you because you could never have paid for your sin. And he paid for it with his own life, death, crucifixion, resurrection. Amen? He says you have redemption in him now, and you're redeemed from spiritual death. You're redeemed from sickness and disease. You're redeemed from poverty. Amen? And then you are to come into God as using the name of Jesus. Now you have privilege and honor to come before the throne. Now that you are in Jesus Christ, you have an inheritance. And you get a lot of things with the inheritance. You get everything. You have an inheritance that you receive life after death. Amen. You are joint heirs with Jesus. And in Galatians 4, 5 through 7, it tells you. In Hebrews 1 through 4, that's Galatians 4, 5 through 7. And Hebrews 1 through 4. You have inherited the name of Jesus, to use liberally. That you have inherited the believer's authority, to use the name of Jesus. You have inherited the entire kingdom of God. It belongs to you. For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead, bodily, and you are complete in him right now. That's the key word, right now. There is nothing that you will have to do to fix yourself. The same way the Bible says, come just as you are. You didn't fix yourself when you get born again. Now, that's a lot of thinking that a lot of people have that, you know, it's just like, you know, companies coming and you want to straighten up the house. You can't fix yourself. Jesus died for you while you were a sinner. He died for the sinners. He didn't die for the righteous. And the funny thing is, nobody could be righteous without him. Amen? Just as you are. Now you're born again, and just as you are. He knows that when you got born again, the provision was made. But if you don't walk in it, you still have a lot of things to straighten out. Yet the inheritance and the kingdom belongs to you. It's not a partial thing. He did it 100% completely. There's nothing left for Jesus to do. He said it's finished, and he sat down at the right hand of God the Father. Amen? You are complete in him. You are heirs to salvation. You have inherited. You are delivered from danger and apprehension and fear. You are delivered from God's wrath. Amen? You are used inclusively to sum up all the blessings bestowed by God on men in Christ through the Holy Spirit. Let me say that again. You are given all of the blessings bestowed by God on men in Christ through the Holy Spirit. Amen? And in Colossians 2:3, it says, all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are given to you. Now, you could walk worthy of the Lord. You are fruitful in every good work. You have length of days. You have riches and honor. You get promotion and honor, and you have protection. In Romans 8, which we discussed several weeks back when we talk about communion, like the woman caught in the act of adultery, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You walk in the Spirit, not in the flesh. You are not in debt to the flesh. You owe nothing to this flesh, but you don't crucify this flesh every day. And you have the power to do it now that you are in Christ Jesus. You also get to inherit all of Abraham's promise in Galatians 3:29. Abraham's promise, Galatians 3:29. Salvation, Hebrews 1:14. The kingdom and its treasures, Colossians 2:3. The name of Jesus to use. The earth, the Bible says the earth and the fullness thereof is yours. Amen. And the very reason for fellowship with the Father, the very reason that we have been redeemed is to fellowship with the Father. Amen. Amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now that you have been born again, you are seated and reigning with Christ in heavenly places. You have to get the garbage out of your mouth. You have to speak God's word over the things in your life. It happens to all of us. It happens to me. I catch myself. That's what the Lord expects you to do. Catch yourself, and quickly fix it. You know, everybody will find their own way. I like to just tell you what I do. It's a life application. If it helps you, then fine. Otherwise, you find your own way. There's not just more than one way. When people sometimes say to me, oh boy, you look so sick. I used to say, I'm not sick, you know, and get all hysterical because, you know, I was a little bit wrong in that way because people could look at you and see. And of course, probably everything I mentioned, I've mentioned already, but we have to learn, okay? We have to get it. So you say, yes, you know, I'm having some challenges, but I thank you for standing in agreement with me for that. Thank you. Of course, if an unsaved person is saying that to you, they can't agree with you for nothing. So you just say, well, praise God, but I know that Jesus is my healer and I'm believing that I'm healed. Okay, but when it's a brethren, you ask them to please stand in prayer agreement with you. And I'll tell you something, the mature brother or sister wouldn't say that. Because when I see people that let's say they have a very bad cold, I don't even notice it because I don't want to give the enemy a foothold. And something else as I'm speaking, like these things are dropped in my spirit because listen, you know, I love you. I love being here. I praise God that I'm here, and I love you. I want myself and you to get it right. I don't want us just to be saved and go to heaven. I want us to live out the fullness of the plan God has for our life in victory in every area. And it can be done through the Word of God. Please, please make some changes. Please listen to the Word of the Lord. It's not Diane's word, you know, it's the Word of the Lord. Now, this has happened to me so many times. In fact, I was sitting in a congregation one day, and the Holy Spirit told me to get up. The pastor was sitting down over to the right. He was sitting in the congregation because somebody else was ministering. And he told me, get up and lay hands on the pastor, that he was having pharyngitis or laryngitis. I don't remember now which one that was. So I just got up quietly and slipped next to him and put my hand on him and asked him if I could pray with him, and I prayed with him. And that's why he was sitting down. That's right, because he couldn't talk. Okay, amen. See, thank you, Lord. And I prayed for him, and I was fully persuaded that he would go home that evening, that he would be healed in Jesus' name. I wouldn't pray for you if I don't have the faith to believe you're healed. Now, you have to have the faith, but my faith is there. When I'm praying for you or laying hands on you, I am fully 100% persuaded that my faith is right there in order for the Holy Spirit to move through me, and that you would be healed in Jesus' name. Now, you know what has happened, and this is not the first time. The minute service was over, everybody started asking him if he has some rum. To go do this with the rum, do that with the rum, drink the rum with the lime, rub the rum here, rub rum, rub rum, drink rum, take a bath in rum, shampoo the rugs with rum. Stop it. It's ridiculous. If rum and lime could do everything for you, you wouldn't need Jesus. You didn't need him to go to the cross. Because as far as I know, no bottles of rum and lime was nailed to the cross at Calvary, okay? So you have to stop it. Stop letting tradition, culture, colloquialism, all kind of crazy kuzumaza. You are a new creation in Jesus Christ now. You have a new DNA. You have a new vocabulary. You cannot put old wine and new wineskin. You wonder why stuff is not happening in your life. You're disobedient, and you're not speaking what the Word of God is saying over your life, you know? And then what happens is, you know, when the older people say these things, everybody thinks, well, you know, that they should just please stop it, please. Because I want you to come up higher. You can't mix all these things. It's either you're on God's side, either you believe he's your healer or not. Now, if you don't believe he's your healer, that's okay too. But if we are standing on agreement and we have the same Bible, all 66 books, how is it that you didn't read what I read? We've come too far. Nobody was born again yesterday. And the people I'm dealing with in these old churches, listen, they've been warming that pew there for 30, 40 years, and quite happy to tell you, okay? So, all right, let me get off that because, you know, amen, hallelujah. So now you are seated and reigning with Christ, amen? Now, after Jesus was raised from the dead, the Bible says God highly exalted him to a position of honor at the right hand of God the Father and gave him a name which is above every name, hallelujah. In Philippians 2:9-11. This is 9. It says, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, that's Jesus, and given him a name which is above every name, that at that name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things being in heaven. Of things. Now, what are things? Things are beings, that at that name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things. And those are beings, okay? In heaven and things, beings. In earth and things, beings, under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And you know what that is? You know, all of the naysayers that don't believe in Jesus and whatever, when Jesus, you know, crashes through the clouds and appears, the Bible says we all shall see him. It says every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Well, of course, I mean, you have Jesus in front of you, you're going to realize, oh, yes, what I heard over these years is true. And you're going to say he's Lord and he's Christ. Amen. In Ephesians 1:19-22, it says, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power, which we wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave to be the head over all things to the church. What did he say? He says he put all things under his feet and gave him to be. Now, who is him to be? The head over all things to the church. The what? The head over all things to the what? To the church. Who is the church? You, my brother, my sister. You are the church. He said he gave all power and he put all things under his feet and gave him head over all things to you. You have the right, you have the authority, you put every single thing that is not of God under your feet. You have all power, all authority, and dominion. God not only gave Jesus a name which is above every name, but at that name of Jesus, every being in all three worlds, heaven, earth, and hell, must bow and confess that Jesus is Lord and confess his lordship and dominion. Hallelujah. God also seated Jesus in the highest position in the universe at his own right hand. Amen. And he made him head over all things in verse 22 we just read. These verses didn't say that God raised Jesus from the dead and set him above all principality, power, might, and dominion. They say that God set Jesus far above all principality, power, might, dominion, and every